I'm Terri Wisdom, and this is Harlem Network News. And as many of you know, Harlem Network News is a new media platform. We started at the onset of COVID, so not so new. We believe that it is important that we tell our own stories. Knowledge is power. We want to assure the community is informed, engaged, and called to action. You can find us on all social media, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and please make donations to HarlemNetworkNews.org or send it to our Cash App or Zelle us at Harlem Network News. You matter and we matter. Today in this Women's History Month, we want to honor a new ancestor, Zenzele Wisit of Howard University, a graduate in the mid-90s, a singer, a songwriter. Follow her on the cloud. A founding member of Soul Food Symphony, an all-girls band born out of Howard University. Zenzi was a midwife. Zenzi was a doula. Zenzi walked her own walk to her own beat, an angel on earth and now in heaven. We also want to salute a new ancestor, Guylen Kane, spoken word artist and co-founding member of the original Last Poets. He was 81 and transitioned last month. As we continue to celebrate Women's History Month, we salute an iconic woman in medicine, and that is in the person of Dr. Uche Blackstock, MD, who has written a New York Times bestseller. The book is called Legacy. And the book Legacy deals with diversity. It's Legacy, a Black Physician Reckons with Racism in Medicine. Dr. Blackstock is the daughter of a Dr. Gail Gloria Blackstock, who is deceased, who was a community activist and served at Kings County Hospital. Her twin sister, Oni Blackstock, Dr. Oni Blackstock, MD, is also a physician. Dr. Uche is the CEO of Advancing Health Equity. Dr. Uche's twin sister is a primary care physician, an HIV physician, researcher, and founder of Health Justice, a racial and health equity consulting practice. Dr. Uche and Oni Blackstone are the first Black Harvard medical students with legacy graduates, following in their mother, Dr. Gail Gloria Blackstock's footsteps. They are also undergraduates of Harvard University. Indeed, their parents, Earl Blackstock and Dr. Gail Gloria Blackstock, were and are community activists and members of the East community in Brooklyn. Today, we feature for a Women's History show, Dr. Uche Blackstock, as she speaks to the Abyssinian Baptist Church, Book Ministry, and Health Ministry. It's a robust conversation with Q&A and more. Knowledge is power. Get the book Legacy. It's a must read. And now take a listen to Dr. Uche Blackstock, MD's discussion with Q&A. Ashe, ashe, ashe. Thank you. Forward ever, backward ever. Thank you.
Women's History Month event. Both the Sister to Sister Ministry and the Health Ministry were conceived by our First Lady, Mrs. Patricia Butts. Wherever she recognized a need, Mrs. Butts would step in and establish a ministry to address it. Today, we are blessed to have a dialogue with Dr. Uche Blackstock, the author of Legacy, A Black Physician Reckons with Racism in Medicine. This book is a must read. It is an eye-opener to some and confirmation to most regarding the inequities that we experience as Black people when it comes to our health care. I am Trustee Sharice Robinson, and I'm the leader of the Sister to Sister Book Ministry. And this is Linda Thompson, and she is the leader of the Health Ministry. We will be facilitating today's event. Thank you for joining us for this informative discussion. We will start with Dr. Uche Blackstock reading an excerpt from her book. Matt.
Dr. Uche
Blackstock works as an emergency room physician in academic medicine. She is founder and CEO of Advancing Health Equities to Improve Black Healthcare, which partners with healthcare organizations to address the factors contributing to health inequities. Dr. Blackstock's mother was the first in her family to attend college and receive her degree as a medical doctor from Harvard University. Her twin daughters, Uche and Oni, followed in her footsteps by also receiving their medical degrees from Harvard University. Now we will hear from Dr. Blackstock.
For having me as a guest today. Thank you to my publicist, Gilda Squire, for being here. And to my talent agent, Tracy Bullsmith is here, also who connected me with Gilda, so it's all family. I'm gonna read about can everyone hear?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, sorry. I'm gonna read probably about a page and a half from the book just to give you all some context. And then I'll answer some questions from Linda and Therese and from the audience. So this intro starts with, when I was a little girl, my twin sister Oni and I used to visit our mother at work. Her name was Dr. Dale Gloria Blackstock, and in the 1980s and 90s, she was an attending physician at Kings County Hospital Center, one of the public hospitals affiliated with SUNY Downstate in Brooklyn, not far from our home in Crown Heights. Our mother worked long hours at her job, and so sometimes we'd head to the hospital after school to see her and do our homework. Walking down the disinfected scented hallways, our shoes squeaking on the linoleum floors, we'd make our way to the large echoing cafeteria, where we'd pull out textbooks from our backpacks and settle down to work alongside the physicians, nurses, technicians, and aides taking a break. The staff behind the counter knew us well, especially because we strongly resembled our mother, and would smile warmly and ask, "Visiting your mother today?" After homework was done, we'd sneak into her clinic to ask for a small change to spend on our favorite red jello. She'd hand it to us, and if we were quiet, let us stay and observe for a minute or two as she examined a patient. Our mother was warm but serious with those in her care. Occasionally, her face would reveal a smile, but more often than not, she was extremely focused on what they were saying and what was going on in their lives. She'd grown up in the same Brooklyn neighborhood where the hospital was located. The daughter of a single mother from New Jersey, raised on public assistance, she'd become the first person in her family to graduate college, which was Brooklyn College. And after graduating from Harvard Medical School in 1976, my mother returned home to her community. At Kings County SUNY Downstate, she wasn't just taking care of her patients, she was tending to her neighbors. In her interactions with them, she always seemed to know as much about their children and families as she did about their respective medical problems. When you came in for a visit with Dr. Blackstock, you weren't only having your blood pressure or cholesterol checked. You were also meeting with someone who was going to assess how your whole being was faring. I believe our mother practiced what is now known as structurally competent and culturally responsive care, which means that the entire complex nature of the patient's background and the social context in which they live, work, love, and pray is considered during evaluation. And her patients loved her for it. She was always bringing home little gifts from them, a knitted shawl, homemade cookies or cake, tokens of appreciation. My sister and I were only 19 years old in 1997 when we lost our mother to leukemia, and she was only 47. She died too young, but by then her influence had indelibly rubbed off on us. Our mother's passion for learning, her dogged perseverance, her commitment to serving her community heavily influenced our own decisions to become physicians. Oni and I both graduated from Harvard University and then attended Harvard Medical School, the school's first Black mother-daughter legacy graduates.
All right.
Like her, we both went to work with historically underserved populations after graduating, my sister at Montefiore in the Bronx, while I went to Kings County SUNY Downstate in Brooklyn, following in our mother's footsteps. In the years since then, I have felt her by my side in so many of my own interactions with patients. Her ability to listen to and truly care continues to be a model for me. And it's something that our patients are crying out for now more than ever. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing that with us. So good afternoon to you, Dr. Blackstock. It is an honor to have you join us today at the City of Baptist Church. Please tell us about your legacy, the reason for writing this book.
So I'm sure by now I can tell one of the meanings of legacy in the title. So the title is Legacy: A Black Physician Reckons with Racism in Medicine. The first legacy is that of being a Black woman physician legacy, which is very rare. We know that still less than 3% of all physicians are Black women. And so when my sister and I graduated from Harvard Medical School in 2005, you know, we were the first, but since then there's only been one other Black mother legacy graduate.
Wow.
I know. So often institutions will pat themselves on the back about all the work that they're doing, but you know, the fact that we're still having seconds, you know, in 2022, that's not enough. And so I really wanted to use my mother's story, my story, to talk about these larger issues about like the legacy of racism in medicine. And in our larger society that continues to negatively impact the health of Black Americans. And so I wanted to really help connect the dots. And I know a lot of us know from our own lived experiences, you know, with our families' experiences and interactions with the healthcare system, to understand like why in 2024 we are still seeing these very appalling statistics as it relates to our health. And that it's not because there's anything inherently wrong with us. There's something very inherently wrong with the systems that we live in within this country, and that's racism.
Did your mother ever share with you any of the challenges of being a Black doctor?
Yeah, no, definitely. I write in the book about how, you know, when my mother, I didn't mention this in that part of the book, but my mother had a chemistry professor at Brooklyn College, a Black man, who really saw her potential and encouraged her to apply to medical school. And she did, and she ended up being accepted to all of the medical schools that she applied to.
Blessings.
Yeah. And so of course, she ends up at Harvard feeling like a fish out of water. You know, her mother had not finished high school, but had gotten her GED, had become a licensed practical nurse, and had done so, you know, she's so proud of all that her mother had accomplished. At the same time, she was in class with other kids who, young people, whose parents were faculty at Harvard Medical School. Some had written the textbooks they were using. One was a family member of Jackie Onassis. Mm-hmm. One's a family member had won the Nobel Prize in immunology, right? So, okay. You know, while she was proud, it was hard not to compare herself to her classmates, but she found her group of family there, other Black students. The year that my mother entered Harvard Medical School, 1972, it was actually the beginning, the early 70s were the beginning of diversity initiatives, aka affirmative action, after MLK Jr.'s assassination. And so she actually had, you know, a decent number of Black classmates. And so she was able to form good friendships with them. They supported each other. But of course, you know, there were times when, you know, people may have been just, you know, instructors may have just talked to certain students and not her, or had very low expectations of how she would perform in school. So there were a lot of interactions that she had with other students or professors that are what we call microaggressions, but they're not so micro, right? They're obviously happened because you're Black.
Right. Yes. Mm-hmm.
So after leaving from practicing emergency medicine and teaching, do you ever miss it?
Okay, so we skipped a lot, but I want to give them some context.
Okay.
No, I want to give some context because so the book is a journey. It's like my journey from child to medical student to resident to practicing physician, and kind of my journey of having to unlearn and relearn things that I was not formally taught in my education or training. And so for a long time, because I had my mother as a role model and she had been in academic medicine, I was like, I want to be a faculty member, because at academic medical centers, they're very intellectually stimulating environments. You get to not only see patients, you get to do research, you also get to teach medical students and residents and other trainees. So it's very exciting. And I had seen my mother do that and I said, oh, I want to do that also. And so then I had my own experience so after Harvard Med School, I went back to Kings County and trained there. I really loved it. But I talk about in the book how it was very difficult environment to work in because the hospital is so under-resourced that I was actually, by the end of my training there, was burning out. And so I actually went eventually and I became a professor at NYU School of Medicine. And that was going to be my dream. Like, that was, I was so excited to get that job. But again, as you mentioned in the opening, here I am in one of the largest emergency medicine departments in the city, in New York City, but I was one of two Black faculty there. So that's a red flag, right? Because it's like when your staff doesn't look like your patient population, you know that you're not doing the work within the department or within the institution to make sure that whoever's taking care of the patient reflects the patient population.
Absolutely.
But you know, of course, we are so used to being in those kind of environments. So I forged ahead. I talk about how I checked off all the boxes that I thought I was supposed to do. I created an ultrasound fellowship in our department. I created an ultrasound curriculum for the medical school. I thought I was doing innovative work. And when I went up from assistant to associate professor, my promotion was denied. And it felt really like a slap in the face. And I know that for us, many, many times, often we're overlooked for promotions or it goes to someone else. I mean, I saw young white men that I had trained, like, you know, rise up within the organization. And just like, you know, thinking about like, what's going on? So sometimes I say how that promotion denial was kind of like, it was a slap in the face, but it was a slap in the face that I needed. And I say that because sometimes we get comfortable. And I think I also had been at a point where seeing all that was happening, seeing these students that I had trained become, like, being promoted, I had actually started thinking that I was someone that did not have gifts to share. You know, when you're in environments where, that often happens to us, where you're undervalued, underappreciated, you actually start forgetting. I started actually feeling average. And I know people would say, how could you feel average? No, I did, because that's what racism does, that's what sexism does, you know. So I made this really difficult decision while I was still at NYU. I said I'm going to start my own consulting firm around diversity, equity, and inclusion and health equity so that I can do the work my way and work with healthcare organizations. And I ended up leaving NYU. And I said, not only am I going to leave NYU, but I'm going to leave all of academic medicine. I don't write in the book, but I was offered actually Associate Dean of Diversity at Harvard Medical School. I turned that down because I said it's going to be more of the same. I need a break. And so, yes, while I do miss caring for like direct clinical care that I did with my patients, a long answer, sorry. I miss seeing my patients, but a lot of the work that I do now around health communications, healthcare advocacy, is so much more impactful than the work I could have done before, especially within an institution.
Thank you.
Did you take all your questions? Or did I answer all your questions?
You know, I have to tell the audience that Dr. Blackstock, it really is a superstar in medicine. And she's really humble and kind of like a regular person, like the rest of you all, with the wonderful things that you do. But she really has done some pretty amazing things. Being one of two at NYU, where they have about 45,000 employees, is a huge ordeal. And she did this, 15 years ago? And she was there for 10 years?
Yeah, 10 years.
She was there for 10 years at the top of her game, and she's still quite young. All right, what you've done, you know, I mean, I love what you've done. Your book is amazing. So if we're going to get some more books here at the church. They went so fast.
Thank you.
So fast. And it's a wonderful read, but can you tell us what you learned from your mother about racism?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, before you do that, tell us about how your mom nurtured you all, you and your sister, to become great people.
And so so I always say at its core, the book is really a love letter to my mother. Yes, she was very, some people in here knew her, just a very, very special woman. And I have to say, now as a 46-year-old, so I'm the same age my mother was when she was diagnosed with leukemia.
Wow.
And you know, she was 47 when she died. And so now I have a greater idea of what it means to be a 46-year-old parent and, you know, author now, and I have my own business. And sometimes I reflect and I grieve that I could not have appreciated the fullness of who my mother was, because she was my mom, but writing the book helped me see that she was so much more than my mom, right? So I talk about how she would get together with the other Black women physicians in our neighborhood and Black physicians in our community and organize community health fairs, right? This is in the 80s. This is when people weren't even talking about health equity, right? But she was doing the work of health equity very early on. And she was recognizing that our patients were not living full, healthy lives because of the systems, because of the kind of care that they received. And they were doing, she and her colleagues were doing her part in making sure that they at least got the education and got some of the wraparound services and connecting them. And so I think that exposure, you know, growing up, I know that most physicians were Black because that's all I saw.
Right.
That's all I saw. My pediatrician, I knew Dr. Mariel Pedioni. You know, so there were so many Black physicians that I knew growing up in Brooklyn. I thought that was the standard, and I didn't realize until I got older that was actually a rarity, that it was a blessing that I could grow up in that kind of environment. But my mother also, because of her childhood, really wanted to give my sister and me everything that she didn't have. So, you know, everything was an educational experience. Every walk in the neighborhood, we would go look at all the flowers and go over what are the different types of flowers, right? Even I talk about during our sleepovers, people knew if they were coming to a sleepover at our house, they're going to get, they have to do a worksheet, a math worksheet, or a reading comprehension worksheet. Yeah.
Wow.
And then we could pop some popcorn and watch a movie.
So you had to do something first.
But she was also obviously incredibly loving, and both she and my father, and I think that's what has really gotten us through a lot of rough times is they really instilled in us a very strong sense of our Black identity, always, no matter what environment we were in. You know, I always remembered my mother waiting in line for a cabbage, during the Cabbage Patch craze, waiting in line to get a doll that was our skin tone, because she wanted to make sure. So that's how my parents were. We had to write essays about what it's like to be young, gifted, and Black, and we had to know, like, who all the famous and even lesser known Black people were in history who contributed to our country. So I feel like that's always been my foundation. And so the times when I've been in these environments and felt average, I've always had to reach back to that and think about, my mother would not want me to be, to ever feel that way, to ever feel like I'm not good enough.
Right, yes. Thank you. You know, I kind of see, it seemed to me that as you look back and you see how you were nurtured, it's kind of like you were in this special incubator, you and your sister, because your parents took you all around to be cultured, right? But you would also see how your friends lived in the other part of Brooklyn.
Right, and I, not just that, but in, you know, we grew up in Crown Heights. You know, we grew up in the 80s in Crown Heights where, you know, talk about seeing people and having seen people get shot on our block.
Right.
And having been there and seen it and then just like running as fast as we could away because we didn't want to get hurt either. You know, even when the shooting the other day on the subway, like I've been on the subway in high school when people are running through the cars and are like, you know, get down. You know, so it's, you know, I've been in those environments, but then also I've been in these other environments that were very privileged as well. But I think also that helps to give you perspective that's needed to look at these situations, look at the current situation we're in and really have a thoughtful perspective about it.
Right.
Like, that's why I always say, like, honestly, we are the gifts. We are the gifts to a lot of these organizations and institutions, Black folks, because we literally come in with perspectives that no one else has.
Mm.
And, you know, they're lucky that we're able to share it with them.
Yes.
But unfortunately, we often leave thinking that we don't have anything to contribute. Mm. We have so much more than anyone else can. Mm.
Doctor, talk to us about the difference between being at NYU, where it is a world-class organization, world-class hospital, and being at Bellevue. Talk to us about the differences that occurred with you as a medical professional.
Right, and so, you know, I had trained at a public hospital, Kings County, but it wasn't until I was faculty at NYU, where we actually work at both Bellevue and NYU, that I was like, oh wow, it's literally a two-tier system where, you know, there are maybe the same faculty that work at the different hospitals, the same staff, but in terms of resources, there's a huge disparity.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of follow-up services, subspecialty services, even trying to get transportation for a patient to get home. It's like jumping through hoops.
Wow.
Or even trying to find a social worker, when it's interesting because the population that Bellevue serves, they need a social worker more than NYU.
Right.
And then even just down to what I observed and how our patients are treated at the different hospitals, there's a different standard for how NYU patients are treated versus Bellevue patients.
Right.
And that's even reinforced, and there are journal articles about this by paramedics will be less likely to bring an unhoused patient or an intoxicated patient who is has had a lot of alcohol to NYU because they don't want to upset the other patients.
Mm.
You know, so, you know, it's like individual behavior kind of reinforces these systemic inequities. And many of my colleagues did not speak up about it. Some of our residents, I talk about how one of my residents who's from young Indo-Caribbean woman, she came and she said, this is horrible. Like, and no one says anything.
Right.
Mm.
Right.
And so there's a lot of silence. People don't want to speak up because obviously either they don't notice or they don't care enough to speak up.
Mm-hmm. Well, so, they're afraid.
So,
as a medical professional with all of your education, when you would go into the rooms of some people at NYU, how did they treat you?
And I would just say this is not just NYU. This happens a lot to Black health professionals and professionals of color, where you're questioned a lot about your qualifications. People would ask me, where did you go to medical school?
Mm-hmm.
Where did you go to college even?
Right.
And I remember I read about a story where I was literally in the room with the patient for at least just 20 minutes straight, and that's a lot for ER, for emergency medicine, who are going from patient to patient. And I got a call from my chief of service who said, oh, the patient in room X said they haven't seen a doctor yet. And I was like, no, I was just in there talking to them. I introduce myself as Dr. Blackstock, but for a lot of patients, because I'm not how a physician looks to them,
right.
It doesn't matter. I could have Big Doctor on my ID, I could introduce myself as Dr. Blackstock, but in their head, it just doesn't register. No, no, and then, you know, a lot of times I've been asked, can they get a second opinion? And I actually have no problem with a second opinion, but the story I talk about is, the person asked, can I get a second opinion? And they said, it's not because you're Black. you brought up the Black part. I didn't say anything.
Right.
So I'm just saying, so the reason why I bring up these experiences is because I know they're not just experiences that I had.
Right.
They're experiences that so many of us have where our capabilities and our skills are being questioned, and we just want to do our job, right? But I write about them in the book because I want to make sure that I affirm and validate the experiences that we have had, because a lot of times we leave the situation thinking, okay, what did that just happen? Am I losing it? Do you feel like you're being gaslit?
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, no, these are the situations. It is happening, and we have to do something about it. It's not acceptable.
Exactly. There was a report that was written, what, back in 1910, the Flexner Report? Can you talk to our people about what that report was all about?
Okay, so I wrote in the book. So the book is, for people who haven't read it, so it's a memoir, but I bring in a lot of history and social commentary. One of the historical pieces I bring in that is very, very important for us is understanding, it's something called the Flexner Report. And I wanted to make sure I wrote about it because I want to make sure that we understand why we see the certain statistics we see today, why I mentioned less than 6% of all physicians are Black. And so it was a report in 1910 that was commissioned by the American Medical Association, which is the largest and oldest organization of physicians. And just so you know, that organization started as predominantly white, is still predominantly white organization. They actually systematically discriminated against Black physicians, you know, did not allow Black physicians to join, even once they had local chapters, still did not, so for a very long time. And the Carnegie Foundation. So they commissioned this report. There was an educational specialist named Abraham Flexner, a white man who actually had very avidly racist writings and teachings, but they commissioned him to assess the standards of all 155 US and Canadian medical schools. So he traveled all around, he compared them to Western European schools and to Johns Hopkins in Baltimore, which is the gold standard at the time in the US. At that time, there were 7 HBCUs. By 1905, they had educated about 1,600 Black students, because at that time, Black students were not allowed into other schools, right? Mm. So this report, though, what it did was it led to the closure of many medical schools, because it said they did not live up to the standards of these other schools. But we know that HBCUs did not have the endowment, mm-hmm. did not have the resources, so it was unfair to really compare them against these schools that did. It did not necessarily mean they were putting out untrained or poorly trained physicians. But what it did was it led to the closure of 5 out of 7 of the historically Black medical schools,
wow.
leaving behind Howard and Meharry.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. So leaving only behind 2 schools. There was a report that came out a few years ago that estimated how many physicians those 5 schools would have trained or educated rather if they had stayed open. Between 25,000 and 35 Black physicians would have been trained by those 5 Black medical schools that closed. And so when you think about that and the impact on our community, think about the number of patients those physicians could have cared for. Hundreds of thousands, maybe even more. You think about mentoring. We know that mentoring, especially in academia, often is done by people who look like, you know, they choose people who look like them, right? So thinking about all of the Black students and trainees who missed out on mentorship. And your career is often determined by how you and who mentors you.
Right.
And then finally thinking about just all of that brain power, all that potential that was lost that could have been done in research, not just in Black health, but health overall. And it's such a tremendous loss to our community, but I want people to understand. And so I talked about this before, like Representative Ayanna Pressley, she talks about policy violence. Mm-hmm. That is an example of policy violence on our communities. Mm. And so it's not overt, it's more covert, right? You don't see someone attacking someone, but you see what kind of destruction that has caused to our communities. Because we know that racial concordance, especially for Black patients, having a physician or health professional that is the same background as you, it makes a difference. It makes a difference in the kind of care, the quality of care that we receive. There's even a study that came out last year that showed that having one Black primary care physician in a US county improves the life expectancy of Black people living in that county.
Wow.
Like it's so powerful. And to think about, you know, today and the recent SCOTUS decision on race conscious admissions a few months ago, that is gonna have a very similar domino effect. Like we are not even gonna know unless something is done to address it, but we're not even gonna know the impact that's going to have on pre-med admissions, medical school, nursing admissions, physician assistant, probably for decades to come.
Did you say wow?
Wow.
Wow.
Whoa.
It seems frightening because it is what has happened.
And what is happening.
And what is happening. We now have a group of folks who are going around mentoring young people. Okay, your mom was your mentor. Mm-hmm. Okay, you'll read about it in the book. Mm-hmm. Her mom was a wonderful mentor that you probably didn't realize the fullness of it until time later when you're reflecting back.
Yeah.
But now we have a group of young people that want to become doctors. Now, we happen to have Lynn Holden here, Dr. Lynn Holden, who...
Listen, this is the queen. The queen! No, truly the queen.
So, you know, I know a lot of doctors, and I've been on a lot of Zooms and in a lot of big rooms with doctors talking and speaking about how we need to raise up a strong group of people to come behind us, become behind you. What do you have to say about being strong and living past the structural racism that is severe, overt and covert, sneaky under the table, it's still happening. How do you talk to young doctors that are coming up?
Dr. Holden, I'm gonna have you, do you mind saying a few words? Would you mind, please? No, because there's so much brain power, but just so much beautiful work that has already been done, that is being done, and Dr. Holden literally is one of the trailblazers.
That's right.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I want to say to everyone, my church family, thank you so much. And Uche was actually part of Mentoring in Medicine, which is an organization that I started along with my husband, Deacon Andrew Morrison, and Deacon Burrell Jeffers. So we all started this in 2017, and the goal was to build a more competitive healthcare workforce, but to do that in areas where people were not looking or were quote unquote hard to find. And so it's just so heartwarming to see Uche, to see Rick Gustav, to see all the Justine Anderson, one of our own, who have been part of the program, who are now flourishing. Almost 600 physicians and almost 1,000 health professionals have come through the program. So what do we say?
Yeah.
We say it takes a village, and part of that village is right here.
Gotcha.
And we have to work together continuously. Everything Uche said is correct. I mean, we're fighting a war. You know, we're sitting over there now, but we're really fighting a war. And so we need your prayers. We know what we're here to do. Faith and works.
All right.
And, you know, just know that we are fighting that fight for you, for all the young people. We even have pre-med students here. We have a medical student here. But all of us, you know, we're in tune. We know what's going on. But we also know what we have to do in order to make it better. So I just want to congratulate you because you are, talk about the queen. You are really doing it, girl. I'm so proud. So proud. Thank you, Dr. Holder. But I'm so glad that you could share some words of wisdom. The work that you do is invaluable for our young people, and that is the future. Like I honestly feel like, and also we are the ones building the solutions,
right?
Because we can't depend on anyone else.
That's right.
Absolutely.
You say something in your book. If you're not furious about this, you're not paying attention. If you're not furious about what Dr. Blackstock has gone through, then you're not paying attention, because so many things are going on around us. So Dr., talk about that a little.
No, truly. I mentioned the SCOTUS decision, but even all of this anti-DEI movement, you know, it's going to affect how healthcare is practiced. It is. There are organizations out there that are targeting health-related programs. They are targeting, for example, like a physician group was actually trying to recruit more Black physicians to different areas, and they offered extra bonus for Black physicians in terms of to pay for travel. This organization is getting sued by the same Edward Blum associated organization that sued, that brought the SCOTUS suit for racism and bias, reverse racism. Mm-hmm. So even there's a program in California that is a Black-led program, but that's providing universal basic income to Black mothers. Mm. That program is being sued. Mm. So all of this is ultimately, like we have to be very, very aware that there is a concerted effort. I mean, even, you know, what happened to President Claudine Gay at Harvard, that was a concerted effort. So we really need to be on like very, very aware of what's happening and get even more organized. Because they're coming for us even and the last thing I'll say, even in dermatology, I don't know if people heard about what happened to dermatology recently at the American Association of Dermatology, that some of their members brought forth a resolution to sunset all DEI programs in dermatology. Mm. Not only does dermatology have less than 3% of all physicians, I mean less than 3% are Black, but we know that there is a trend that of Black patients being diagnosed too late with skin cancer and other dermatologic conditions that compromise our health and our length of life, because people are not trained to recognize what certain skin diseases look like in our melanated skin.
Right.
So, but this group of physicians brought forth this resolution and said, we don't need these DEI programs. They're saying that they're divisive.
Oh my.
Yeah, mm-hmm. They're using very, very dangerous language. So we have to be aware of what's happening. We have to get organized.
I know we have to go to Q&A, but quickly, can you tell us, what would you say to the 17-year-old Dr. Blackstock before she became Dr. Blackstock about what you're going to have to go through to be a successful doctor?
So that's a complex question, only because, you know, there are only so many things that I could do as individuals. I think of the same question as, like, what do you tell patients when they go into the healthcare system?
Right.
The healthcare system is broken. So it's like you're going against like systemic issues. But I will say it's like, you know, find your village of people,
mm-hmm.
find your families, chosen in blood, your church family, your faith. I would say when you're in school, find those faculty and staff that are there to support you. Like I felt that as an obligation for me when I was in academic medicine to be there for our students. And I still am. I just actually had a call with one of my mentees yesterday. We've been in touch since she was a first year medical student.
Wonderful.
So just keep those people who see your light, can support you, keep those people very, very close to you at all times. And I also just want to say that a lot of, I know things may seem a little, you know, I don't want to leave it, you know, kind of feeling a little, you know, not on a positive note, but I want to say there's so many wonderful things, just like programs like Dr. Holden's program, but also other programs really focused on health, like I write about in the book, the Roots Birthing Center is a model. It's in Minneapolis, mm-hmm. which has some of the highest racial health inequities, highest maternal mortality rates.
A Black midwife, she founded the Roots Birthing Center with the direct mission of providing respectful and dignified care. And what they've been able to do is decrease maternal complication rates, preterm deliveries. So there are so many community partners, community-based organizations out there, Black-led, that are doing really, really wonderful work that we need to help fund. We need to uplift their messages. We need to support them. Because again, I think a lot of solutions there are around us. They just don't get as much attention.
Thank you. So there's always hope. There's still hope.
Have to.
And there's still faith. And there's still lots of work for us to do. I could talk to Dr. Blackstock and ask questions all day, but I know some of you all have questions, so.
Well, before you go, I just wanted to ask one more thing. You mentioned that you had company over, sleepovers, that there were like math challenges and things. Do you do any of those things with your sons? And I understand that you have affirmations that you do.
Yes, so I'm probably not as, my mother, in terms of our academics, was very, like, we had to make sure we got, you know, certain grades. I'm probably not as hard on my kids as my mom was on us. I felt like we did that, I mean, we did well. But I also just want them to really enjoy learning for the sake of learning, one. I don't want them to feel a lot of pressure on them. They're only 7 and 9, but I have them do affirmations. They're two boys, and I have a list of 20 affirmations. It's in our dining room, and it's sentences from like, I'm proud to be Black, to I love my hair, I'm a good person,
right.
I am kind. So just like the things that we repeat all together, and I have them say it out loud, because that's actually what I do for myself too. If you were to see my mirror at home, I wrote on my mirror a New York Times bestseller.
All right.
Okay. I wrote it months ago. I wrote, you deserve all the goodness that's coming your way.
Nice.
Because I feel like, you know, we get all this messaging that tells us otherwise, especially as Black folks, that we really have to remind ourselves and be around people who help remind us that we deserve goodness. And that's part of the work that I want to do in just raising and writing this book, and in the work that I do with my organization, Advancing Health Equity. We deserve to live long, full lives. At a minimum. I mean, those are, you know, when you think about how our lives are cut short by disease in this country, those are birthday parties missed, graduations, good times, just like, I mean, just love, right? So we deserve to live long, full lives. And so I want to make sure that no one forgets that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hi, Dr. J. Thank you so much for this work. I spoke to you earlier and I just said that, you know, I'm a doula.
Yes.
And I'm in this system with you. I'm on the front lines with you. I want to pull it back a little bit because like you, I was a little girl. I did not have such a unique name. Could you tell me two things? Number one, what's the meaning of Uche and Onye for your sister and you? And also, could you also talk about your twin? Does she feel or had similar experiences going through this calling that you both have?
Yes, she does. She just doesn't want as much attention. But she doesn't like the attention. She doesn't, you know, she's a little bit more reserved. So definitely a lot of the work. And actually, there are people here who worked with my sister at the New York City Department of Health, where she was assistant commissioner for the Bureau of HIV.
Right.
And a lot of the work that she did was bringing in a racial equity lens, the HIV work, because what a lot of people don't know is that a lot of the new HIV infections are actually among Black heterosexual women, right? And so that is something, and that's not something that you see, you know, in terms of fundraising happening for this group. Like, so a lot of the work that she did was bringing an equity lens to that work. And she continues to do with her organization, Health Justice. Yes,
nice.
And so, Uche is wisdom, and then Oni is the different meanings, but it's like the title of a leader, a title of a chief.
Okay. Thank you so much. It's an honor to have you here. I'm Terri Wisdom, and I'm part of the Abyssinian Book Ministry, and I do something called Harlem Network News, and I also was honored to see you get your award with your sister at the Harlem Fine Arts Show. Got pictures for you. But I had a question. I didn't totally finish the book, but a question that I had, because I know that there were lots of historical sites that you had in the book just regarding, you know, I guess white people thinking that we had different bodies or different systems, and we got diagnosed because of that. But I also wanted to ask the question, and I guess I'm, you know, obviously not a medical person, but I know that there are some things that are different for us in health and how those are being addressed. Because, you know, there's some things where everything is the same, but there are some things that we are different and need different treatment because of it. So I didn't finish the book, but I just wondered if you address that. And I know I read in the book your family is from the East, and Jito and my partner is actually the creator of the Huggy Bean dog, which is that black dog you were talking about. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
We appreciate you.
Yeah, so I think, you know, I don't get very detailed in it, but, you know, so there's this idea of, so in the book I talk about these notions of called racial essentialism or biological essentialism that I feel like is perpetuated through medicine, right? So we talked about cup kidney function. It was based on a myth that black people had higher amounts of muscle mass. So for a very long time, even some hospitals still use it, there are a different set of normal values for black people's kidney function and non-black people. And what that actually led to was that led to harm, because that led to people who actually had impaired kidney function not being referred to specialty care soon enough, or not being placed on the kidney transplant list. And so now, actually, the kidney registry is going back years to find out patients that may have been missed. I know. Yeah, and even, for example, the pulse oximeter. So a lot of people know about the pulse oximeter. It's a little machine that you put on the end of your finger to measure blood oxygen level. That has been known for about 30 years that provided inaccurate measurements in people with darker skin tones. We had most health professionals, we were not told that. We found that out actually during the height of the pandemic because there's a few studies that were done that showed that black patients and patients with darker skin didn't receive certain COVID treatments because the pulse oximeter said their oxygen levels actually higher than it was. So those are some things you know, that's really important to think about. Putting diverse patient populations into clinical trials. That's why we want to make sure that we have black people well represented. But the other piece that you were mentioning is I talk about sickle cell disease in the book, right? Mm-hmm. And sickle cell disease is actually an inherited disorder. It's a genetic disorder. And so, but what happens is that in the US, most of the people with sickle cell disease are black.
Right.
So it's been racialized as a black disease here, although it affects people from all around the world, the people in the Mediterranean that carries this gene, right? But because it's been racialized as a black disease, it has not received the funding that other inherited diseases like hemophilia or cystic fibrosis. So even though it was first described like almost over 100 years ago, you don't have as many treatments for it. And that's why we end up seeing patients with sickle cell disease in the ER often for their pain crises, because it's not properly managed as an outpatient, because that system, that structure is not there for them. And then they have to deal with interpersonal bias and prejudice from health professionals who think that they are there seeking pain medication, right? So that's another insult, right? So you have that, but then there are, for example, certain types of breast cancers that we know that black women are more likely to get, that there is, that are more aggressive, that are associated with certain genes. So that is still, we're trying to figure out, like, what is that? Is that something, you know, is it maybe environmental related? We don't know, but we know that there is some sort of genetic component to that. Again, I think it's still important to say that you know, race is a social construct, and then but racism through its practices and policies can actually, and then the final thing is epigenetics. Since have people heard of epigenetics? So it's this idea that living with chronic stress, whether it be from living in an impoverished area, living with everyday racism, it actually changes how genes are expressed. It turns them on and off. And so it's thought that actually epigenetics also has a factor in why we see higher rates of diabetes in our community, autoimmune diseases among Black women, inflammatory diseases like atherosclerosis or heart disease. So that's a component as well. So there's so much that our, you know, our researchers have been doing for, you know, studying for quite a long time, still need to kind of clarify what's the role of our environment? What's the role of genetics? So much to know.
Okay, thank you.
But so much for us to know, so that when we Absolutely. Do seek help from health professionals, even, you know, that we know what the right questions to ask. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes.
Just a quick question. Is there some type of directory if we're looking for a Black dermatologist or a Black, you know, that we can go to, since from what you're saying that we might get a diagnosis that might not be from a Caucasian person, that might not be true. And so I would feel comfortable knowing that maybe some of the Black doctors are aware of the disparities for each specialty that we have.
So NMA has a directory, right? But I don't know how... I just saw that some NMA folks here. I wanted to make sure, or NMA related people here. So yes, so National Medical Association, their website definitely, but yes, Help and Her Hue, which actually my friend Ashley Wisdom, who is a public health professional, she starts, so Help, H-E-A-L-T-H, Help, N-I-N, Her, H-E-R, Hue. So Help and Her Hue. It is a directory of health professionals who are actually either of color or not even all, they actually just started a few years ago having non-health professionals of color, but who are trained and get continuing education in providing culturally responsive care. And I know they just got another round of funding. So they actually started as a startup. But Ashley has her whole team of Black women that really are focused on, you know, providing culturally responsive care. So there's Help in Her Hue. I know for maternal health providers, there's the Earth app, IRTH, that Kimberly Ayers Seal started that one. And that's a directory of different types of maternal health providers with different birth workers, OBGYNs. But yes, I definitely see the need to have like a very comprehensive directory of Black health professionals of all different, you know, backgrounds, whether it's, yeah.
There's also blackdoctor.org.
Oh, right.
And Googling, if you actually put in Black doctor, you just see, and some names actually might come up, it's actually specified.
Right.
So there's pictures and things associated with everybody.
Blackdoctor.org. Yes. Thank you.
So we're going to take our last question because the good doctor is going to sign some books and we're going to get ready to have our lunch. So who has the last question? Last question, yes, in the front.
Okay, so. So my question is two-part, actually. One is Henrietta Lacks. I know that. You mentioned it in your book, and I just wanted to know, where do you see us now versus then in changing what happened back then? That's number one, the first part of my question. And the second part is AI. Do you think that will change at all with diversity and inclusion? I mean, how does it factor in? Where do you see that happening in medical?
Okay, so I think Henrietta Lacks, I write about in the book how when I was in medical school, my first year was in 2001, and in my histology class, we had used the cells taken from her without her consent, HeLa cells, but I was not given we were not given the context where those cells came from, right? And I talk about how it wasn't until I had graduated medical school, and I think I finished residency, that I realized where those cells came from, and I start crying because I couldn't believe it. So, you know, Henrietta Lacks was a young Black woman in her early 30s living in impoverished Baltimore with her family, and she had gone to Johns Hopkins with symptoms. She had a vaginal bleeding, but she ended up being diagnosed with advanced uterine cancer. Yeah, and so she ended up passing away, but her cancer tissue was taken from her without her consent, and actually used not just by Johns Hopkins, but by by medical companies, like pharmaceutical for research, even developing, so many different ways, developing the polio vaccine. It was actually used not necessarily in the COVID vaccine development, but in some of the preliminary research. Her cancer cells, they had observed that they were able to replicate very, very quickly. And so they've been used, but her family had never received any compensation. I think until recently they received it, but obviously, I feel like those are one of those the moments in history where we talk about medical mistrust in our communities, but I talk in the book about the institutional untrustworthiness, that institutions have not proven themselves trustworthy to our communities. And so when something like the pandemic starts and you want people to take a vaccine that by all appearances was developed quickly for them, and we can go through all that, but people have understandably have hesitancy about wanting to do that. So I do think that there needs to be full recognition of what happened, reconciliation processes, reparative work with our communities, and I think that cannot just start when there is an emergent reason. So it can't just start because a pandemic happens. It has to be ongoing work. I always think that the way that we run health institutions should be very community-centered. We should have community members on the board. There should be a community governance model. You should be getting consistent and constant feedback from community members about the kind of care that they're receiving, what do they think health equity metrics should look like. These are things that's not good rocket science, but it doesn't happen as it should. And then for AI, I feel like for artificial intelligence that just like with any other piece of technology, it has to be used in the appropriate way, and that obviously bias and racism can impact what happens. So, for example, there was an algorithm that several health insurance companies and hospitals were using. There's an article in Nature about this about 2-3 years ago. They were using this algorithm to calculate the amount of resources chronically ill patients needed. This algorithm consistently allocated fewer resources to Black patients than white patients, even though the Black patients were as sick or more sick. And the reason why is because the data set that they had been using, the software developers had not thought to understand why were Black patients underutilizing the system less. And a lot of it was because of barriers to care. Right. So again, if you have a set, they call this the garbage in, garbage out. When it comes, so if you don't have software developers that are thinking critically about why a data set looks a certain way, and then you're basing an algorithm on that data set, you actually can perpetuate and cause more harm. So we need more diverse software developers. We need them to have an equity focus when they're developing software, or else AI can just reinforce harms.
Yeah. Thank you.
Let's give our wonderful doctor.
Everyone is so hungry. Thank you so much.
We're gonna get some more books because we have 10 cases of books, and between last week and this week, they're all gone. There's a couple that are coming down that I had put in Naomi Graham's office, so that's about maybe 6 of them. But the list of names that I have here, they're gonna get them first. But I'll order another. Several cases of books because we need to get the word out, and if we're really, really good, maybe we can beg our good doctor to come back another time and spend time with us.
You don't have to beg.
The doors of the church are open for that. We really love having you here.
We love it, and we look forward to assisting what needs to get done, because we're an active church and we like working, and we look forward to doing some great things with you in the future. So let's thank her again, and she can sign the books of those who have not got her book signed. I'm going to get some.
Thank you so much. I want everybody to go eat.